Hi, this is the Bet Central podcast. Let's make some profit.
Hello, everyone. Welcome back to the Bet Central Formula One podcast. My name is Sean Parker. I've got, as always, opposite me, Mary-Anne Wakefield. Welcome back, Lally. So good to have you back on the pod. The last time we chatted was the Monaco Grand Prix, and we were just chatting off air and being quite happy with ourselves in terms of our predictions. Charles Leclerc finally getting that monkey off his back and winning his home race. What a special moment. It seems like there wasn't a dry eye in the principality on that Sunday. Just sum up for you what the Monaco Grand Prix was about.
It was so special, and I love Monaco. So, you know, the Saturday is where the race actually gets won, and Christian Horner actually said on the Saturday the winner will be announced on Saturday, basically. Charles was doing so well all the time, and it just, you know, when Sunday came, the only thing they could have done was mess up the strategy, and that's the only way you could have lost. So they did really well. Look, the couple of minutes, we thought also Sainz was going to be out. That turned around. So for him leading in the end, it was just beautiful. And I mean, I shared all the social media and how everybody was just, it was beautiful. It was a beautiful win. And I think for the sport, we needed it as well, because, you know, everybody's on about Red Bull dominance, and we're kind of seeing the dominance decline a little. So I think for a new winner in Monaco, it was just beautiful. It was really great.
Yeah. Good win for Leclerc. Hasn't won for a while. I think it's in 36 Grand Prix. And another feel-good win after Lando's first Grand Prix win this season as well. A lot of the other drivers congratulating Leclerc on that. So, yeah, Ferrari looking strong. So did McLaren. And obviously there were, as you mentioned, those first two incidents on the lap. Actually, there were a couple of incidents. Sainz getting involved. There was also a big, massive crash between Kevin Magnussen and Nico Hülkenberg in the Haases, and with Sergio Perez. Just touching on Perez, news coming out from Red Bull this week that they have re-signed the Mexican on a two-year multi-deal. So you'll be there for the next 2 years. So that, there are pieces of the puzzle in terms of Nexus drivers lineup that are now being confirmed. Your reaction to Red Bull's decision?
I was quite surprised because, you know, last year we kept on having, he may lose a seat, he may end in whatever race we were waiting for, he was going to retire, et cetera, et cetera. And Perez has been doing well in the beginning of the year, but now I'm seeing he's like dipping a bit. And we know when he goes into a dip, it's hard for him to get out. So I was quite surprised by that. But then again, you know, Perez is a good sort of teammate. He doesn't complain too much. He just gets on with everything. So Max can really shine. And that's, you know, that's what Red Bull sort of wants. So he's generally, you know, he just basically does his work and does his thing. He's quiet about it. So maybe that's also why they gave him the deal. I think maybe Yuki, because you would have thought they would have either brought up Yuki from, you know, the ranks, etc. But yeah, maybe Yuki's just not ready yet. So that was a bit surprising for me, but good for Perez.
Yeah, Perez brings a lot to Red Bull. You eat the money on, you eat the nail on the head. I think in being a good second driver. He doesn't have the skill to take on Max. I think bringing in Sainz may have been very, very difficult.
Just hold him. Yeah.
Yeah, as I was saying, Perez brings so much to Red Bull. He doesn't have the skill to battle Max. So Max, you know, is the shining star and he's the number one driver. Obviously, with Carlos Sainz being without a seat for next season, he was, you know, very much linked with the second seat at Red Bull. Obviously, him and Max were teammates at Toro Rosso, but apparently there was tension between the two dads. Carlos Sainz Sr. and Charles Verstappen didn't get along. In addition to that, Perez has a lot of financial muscle in terms of Mexican sponsorships and companies that he brings to the team. So next time, or at this weekend's Canadian Grand Prix, have a look at all of the companies that are, whose stickers are on the car that are actually linked to Perez, or just give it a Google. I'm a little bit upset that Red Bull don't have the trust in Yuki. I think he's the second best driver in terms of the four drivers across Red Bull and RB. I think he's made a good account of himself in Formula One so far. And I know, you're also a big fan of his. Mary-Anne, quickly, the other piece of driving news that we heard this week was Esteban Ocon, Alpine, the French team, announcing that the end of the season will be Esteban's last with the team. He's been there for 5 years. He started with his junior program at Enstone, very, very closely linked to the team. Obviously, what happened in Monaco wasn't, the reason why he got cut with Alpine. Obviously, we are talking about the first lap incident where he came on the inside of Pierre Gasly, and there was a huge crash, and obviously Ocon was out of the race. In terms of his time at Alpine, we knew that going into it, the two of them weren't going to be the best of friends. They've had the issues from karting and in the junior days. So was it ever going to work, Mary-Anne?
Yeah, so, it is kind of sad that he is leaving Alpine because, it's sort of like an all-French outfit there with Gasly as well. But yeah, it just, from day one, I was really worried where I just thought, is this going to work? Because they have had, they've rubbed against each other a few times. And they did say, okay, we're putting it aside. And I think everybody thinks now because he announced this, or Alpine announced, they think it's because of Monaco. But it's actually not. It's been going on for a while. Where you can see and you can hear on the radio that they get irritated with each other. And I think Alpine at the moment is struggling. They were doing so well last year as sort of like a midfield team. And I just think, they've got a vision for probably getting back into the midfield. And, they just sort of want to put their heads down and sort this out. But now they keep on having this driver interaction and like sort of trying to keep them calm. And I think, I think Esty Bestie is probably suited elsewhere, not near Gasly, because also, you know, he has accidents and things and the team gets upset. They don't have money for it. So, I think he'll be suited elsewhere. I'm not really sure where he's going to go. But, it's sad, but I think it's better for his career.
Yeah, agreed. Okay, so we've got the news out of the way. Let's get chatting about this weekend's race. It's the Canadian Grand Prix. So from Europe to North America, the F1 circus goes. Gilles-Villeneuve circuit, beautiful track, 4.3 km, if I'm not mistaken. So again, not very long. But let's chat about the track. Some famous corners, the Wall of Champions, and all of these iconic things. And obviously, we chat about it every year when we go to Canada. Mary-Anne, just info details, and then also just kind of chat to us about the setup for the cars this weekend. Very, very different to Monaco, where, you have the short and medium speed corners. They aren't really corners. I mean, it's almost like making a U-turn every third turn.
So we've got 70 laps and 3 DRS zones, 305 kilometers.
I'm so excited for more DRS zones.
305 kilometers a circuit length. And do you know who is actually the record holder here? Is Bottas for 1 minute 13 in 2019. So nobody's broken it yet, which is crazy. Yeah, it's a fast track, so they are going to be doing, it's a low downforce track. So in Monaco, it was high downforce. And a lot of people said to me last week, yeah, but look how well, you know, the cars are doing, or the drivers that's normally in the back are doing so well. So I said, you must remember, Monaco is much slower. So now those cars that always do, don't do well, etc., they looked good at Monaco. So now when we get to Montreal, it's probably going to go back to the way they were looking. Yes, we have the iconic Wall of Champions, where quite a few famous drivers went into it. And the track, in some areas, the track is a bit narrow. So we may see a safety car. And generally, it is a two-stop. Generally, it's medium to hard. Who knows? Ferrari seems to be doing very well with the tires, so they may do a one stop. I don't know. Also, a lot of braking zones, so that's going to eat the tires. And also, it's predicted to rain this weekend. Now, we've known when there was rain before, they sort of called it off. It wasn't very safe. But we do know the drivers that can drive in the rain. So let's see what happens. It's going to be very interesting.
Yeah, back to a traditional racetrack, which I think, yeah, we love. We love to see these drivers really, yeah, just show their skill. And I think, yeah, Montreal, one of the fastest tracks on the circuit, you know, in terms of average speed and stuff. And yeah, interesting. Obviously, last week, there wasn't, 2 weeks ago, there wasn't a mandatory pit stop. It was quite funny, man. And obviously, listening to Verstappen's radio, him saying that this race is boring and swearing, and him and George Russell coming up with different concepts to kind of make Monaco interesting. But it's quite funny. If he's leading and he wins the race, you know, then the race isn't boring. But, you know, when it's one of his rivals, you know, then yeah, there are things that you have to do and whatever. So, yeah, but we don't have to worry about that. I think the chances of a red flag are quite high. You know, you mentioned these fast corners, and every single race, there's always a high chance of drivers going off. You know, we've seen it in practice. We see it, and we think to ourselves, okay, cool. They know where, you know, they're driving at 10 tenths at that corner. Maybe they'll take it a little bit easier. No, they seem to, you know, struggle sometimes at the same areas. I think about Perez. You know, in certain instances we've seen him go off at certain parts of a racetrack, you know, over and over a weekend. Okay, so we know that McLaren's upgrades have brought them into serious contention. Lally, we've seen obviously Lando winning. Oscar has been on the podium. Such a great performance for him to get onto the rostrum at Monaco. You know, definitely one of the things to tick off for a driver. But let's talk about who are the strongest teams going into the Canadian Grand Prix. Is it once again Ferrari, McLaren, Red Bull? Does Merck have a chance here? You know, we've obviously seen Aston Martin kind of fall off the wayside a bit. But are the three kind of core teams who have been doing well this season, are they the front runners heading into Canada?
Definitely. I think, you know, McLaren has been doing so, so well. And, you know, normally after, yeah, they brought the upgrades to Imola, and then we had Monaco, which is much, much slower. So you couldn't see the upgrades that well. So now we're going to see a takeoff in Canada. I see them doing well. Piastri on these kind of tracks does lack some race pace, but the car is doing so well at the moment. So I think, you know, when he goes into practice and all of that stuff, he can sort it out. Definitely top team McLaren. And I feel the Ferraris and McLaren are going to be fighting each other. Ferrari, I think Charles is going to do very well. This track does suit Sainz though, but Sainz is been having some issues in the last two races or so. But I do feel definitely, you know, they're bringing the fight to Red Bull. They're much closer. If you've been watching the last few races, the timing. So normally, you know, you have Max up there and it's the other teams are 20, 30 seconds behind him. Now it's really, really close. Mercedes, yeah, you know, Lewis never got the upgrade that George had last week, which doesn't really show as much again because Monaco is so slow. So now we're going to see what's going to happen here. But, you know, like most people are saying, they're kind of in no man's land. I can't believe I'm saying this. They're like a midfield team. Alonso, it is Lance's home race. So who knows? Stroll might bring something to the party. Alonso's been doing okay, but the car has been letting him down. So this is going to be a good test to see what Canada and the car can do, and it will kind of sort of predict how the rest of the races are going to go on the traditional circuits.
Yeah, I like the fact that we're going to be able to, you know, that the race is, that the race isn't going to be sorted out on the Saturday. You know, even if a driver qualifies, you know, on the second row of the grid or even the third row, they do have a chance of winning. You know, and I think it's really difficult for us to leave Max out of the picture. You know, we know when he's needed to grind out a result, he has been able to do that. We obviously saw that happen at Imola, where, you know, he beat Norris. So we definitely throw in Leclerc, Sainz, Norris, Max into that mix for pole position and also for the race victory. Just picking out who you think will grab pole on Saturday, and then who you think will win the race and finish on the podium on Sunday.
I think I think Charles, the way he's driving now, and he's sort of like, you know, he's on the winning streak. I feel that Charles is going to win pole. He's really good in quali. We know that. Lando also excellent in quali. Max, like I said before, the Red Bull, they turn it down, and then on the last two laps, he pushes it out. So, but I definitely see Ferrari, McLaren, and then possibly Red Bull if they don't have any issues with the car.
Yeah, let's see what Perez does this weekend after, you know, the news of his new deal. He's gonna need to really help Max. In the Constructors' Championship as well as the Drivers' Championship. Leclerc has now reduced that points deficit to Max to, I think, around 33 points. Just before we go, there are a couple of things I want to chat about. We've seen all of these incidents over the past couple of races, particularly with Kevin Magnussen. So just a nice update for people in terms of penalty points. So introduced a couple of years ago, a Formula One driver couldn't pass the threshold of 12, couldn't exceed 12 penalty points, otherwise they would get a one-race ban. Heading into Canada, there are a few drivers who are not doing great. I'm just going to read off. So, one of our faves, Fernando Alonso, is currently on 6 points. So, yeah, it would be quite interesting for him to pick up points in this race to get him over the threshold, which is quite unlikely. His teammate Lance Stroll, at his home race, he's on 7 points. Sergio Perez, been involved in quite a few scuffles this season, is on 8. Logan Sargeant also on 8. And then K-Mag, who has just been in the wars with everyone. I don't know who he sits next to at dinner or when the grid goes out for dinner. They must rag him. They must definitely have a go at him. He's on 10. So as I mentioned, 12 points is the threshold. He needs to, yeah, just cool it down and not get involved. And again, Mary-Anne, you spoke about it earlier on in the pod, the cost cap, you know, doesn't have the resources, the personnel, you know, the backup of parts and everything like that to compete with the other team. So they need to make sure that their cars come back home after the Grand Prix in one piece. And yeah, I'm sure he's gotten a talking to. I wonder what Gunther would have said to him after all of these things that happened. I think he would have been thrown into that Monaco ocean. I think he would have been thrown into into the French Riviera. Yeah, your final thoughts heading into the Canadian Grand Prix, anything that people need to know ahead of the race?
So we sort of, halfway through the year kind of thing. You're in June now. And something interesting I thought I should mention is Max is sitting on 169 championship points. Last year, June, he was 318. Wow. So the race is tight. Leclerc is behind him at 138 and Norris at 113. Red Bull so far is 276 points for constructors. Last year, there were 503 at this point. So basically, the championship was his already. So, you know, with Ferrari and McLaren doing so well, there's going to be a fight. I'm not saying that the teams don't fight every race, but that championship can be taken away from Max. So let's watch what's happening there.
Yeah. I don't think F1 has been this exciting since Hamilton Verstappen. And yeah, both championships are wide open. It's so good to have Ferrari and McLaren challenging. Yeah, let's enjoy this weekend's race, and we'll be back soon. Thanks guys for watching. Please subscribe, like the video, give us a comment on Spotify, and follow across Bet Central, and also us on social media. Our handles will pop up below us. Cool. Mary-Anne, have a lovely week, and enjoy the race.
You too. Thanks, Sean.